Hey everyone, this is Andrea. I wanted to send you a little video about 4E cognition just to go with the podcast that I'm doing with Shay Welch and Elena Kufari because we talk about 4E cognition. And I wanted to say what that is, which cannot be done in a short video. However, I will link you to a lot of resources. And just the short version is 4E cognition is embodied, embedded, inactive, and extended. However, it's also ecological and environmental and emotional, depending on where you're coming from. At least I think so. But in general, we can think of these E's as helping us understand that cognition is not in the head or in the brain. And I think there's a lot of wonderful things about computationalism. Jerry Fodor, who's a philosopher with this idea of language of thought and computationalism. However, I also think embodied cognition and this world of 4E, which can kind of fit into embodied cognition, but not really, but it is all with the body and the environment as an ongoing dynamical system. That's sort of the point. But I think we really need this because the computationalism, this idea of thinking of thought as a language in the brain, is very good for understanding together, representationally, externally, representationally, how we might understand what the brain is doing. For me, that doesn't cancel out what's happening in 4E cognition, which is taking the body seriously as a means by which we come to knowledge. Which, unless you think you're something different than your body, how else would you come to knowledge? And mind and spirit are part of that. There are different words we use to talk about different parts of that, very different experiences. However, your body, your sensuality is how you come into a lot of your knowledge. So embodied just means it is not in the head. It's not in the head. It involves the whole situation of the environment. It's not just about neurons firing. It's about the dynamical relations of your body in a world that never stops, if you think about it. From the moment you're born till now, everything's been ongoing. There's not a pause button. All of that is creating what you experience sort of at the tip of the iceberg as thinking. But cognition itself is a deep process of the body, at least according to this view, and which I agree with very much on that level. It's also embedded, which is another way of talking about how it's within all of these interactions that we have. It's in the environment. Your body's important. So every body will differ, and therefore every mental experience will differ somewhat because of the way the body is in the world, because of the embeddedness of the body being coupled with or in a dynamical, ongoing interaction with everything that it encounters. You could also think of this ecologically in terms of Gibson, which we've talked about a lot on the show. Of course, all of these things, different people have different ideas about it. But this is just a general big view of it, of how the interaction of the body and whatever you think of as not the body, the environment, the ecological world, is in an ongoing interaction, a dynamical ongoing interaction. And that has to do with what we call mind or cognition. And then inactive. This is a very important word, I think. Inaction was started by one of our previous guests, Evan Thompson. There's a lot of history that went into that, as they talk about in a book called The Embodied Mind, which I have right here, actually. As they talk about in this book, Embodied Mind, which I highly recommend. So that's Evan Thompson, who was on the show, and Francisco Varela and Eleanor Roche. And in this book, they coin a term, so to speak, they coin a phrase of inaction as a new cognitive science, which pretty much does what I've just been discussing, takes the body seriously, which comes out of a whole phenomenological tradition, which they explain in the book, but also looks at the brain as an obviously important part of cognition, but as the brain being in a constant ongoing relationship with the body, which is in a constant ongoing relationship with the world that it's moving through, that it's part of. And there's many different dynamical systems and layers that can be studied out of that. I'll just read you one little part of this book, page 8, very early on, when they start to introduce what inaction is. This is when they introduce the word inactive. And they say that we propose as a name the term inactive to emphasize the growing conviction that cognition is not the representation of a pre-given world by a pre-given mind, but is rather the enactment of a world, the enactment of a world and a mind on the basis of a history of the variety of actions that a being in the world performs. So that might sound complicated, but it's an embodied being which has a path. It's been making its way, and all of that's going into whatever we might be studying as cognition, or whatever we might be experiencing as thinking or as mind. And it's inactive, it's ongoing, it's a dynamical system. There's so much more to this, and it's very rich, but that's just the general idea. So they use the word inaction, and that's an important word. And I just want to read one little part here. So instead of representing an independent world, we enact a world as a domain of distinction that is inseparable from the structure embodied by the cognitive system. So there's a lot more to that. And then there's the fourth E, or the fifth, or the sixth, or the seventh, or the eighth, depending how many E's you want to put in here. But normally in four E's, the fourth one is extended, which means that what we think of as mind doesn't stop with the skull. For example, this computer that I'm talking to you now on, somehow this is becoming a part of our cognition. It's extended into that. There's a lot of controversy about what that really could mean. I would look at some videos with Andy Clark that I'm putting in the show notes, because he took this idea from Gregory Bateson, who had the idea of like a walking stick. When a person is walking, the walking stick is sort of an extension of them. And if you think of that in terms of mind as an extension, when you write something in your notebook, that's sort of an extension of your mind. You need that notebook if you, for example, don't want to forget a list of certain things. And that notebook becomes a kind of extended system of your cognition or your memory. So it's a really interesting idea. There's a great paper by Andy Clark and David Chalmers, another two famous philosophers. All of that I'm putting in the comment section here. And also on the website, there's a ton of links. Just look at them, or look at the Substack post, and you can find out all kinds of wonderful things about this. Watch lots of videos with people talking about it, these philosophers who came up with these ideas. But the big idea of 4E cognition is it's in the head, but it's not only in the head. So it's in the head, but it's not only in the head. It's in the ongoing interaction of your body and the world around you and everything you're encountering. So if you really think about that, then you start to realize how much what you experience every day, what you read, what you look at, the conversations you have really do matter for your mental health and just overall for the habits you're forming cognitively. In any case, that was definitely not enough, but I said I would keep this short because I just wanted a little introduction to go along with the podcast, and that was it. So thanks a lot. And of course, as usual, send me emails or questions right on the Substack, right in the comments below, whatever you want. It's all open for discussion. Okay, thanks for being here.